Bless the Lord, oh my soul. A new day.
Good morning, YCA. My name is Annalie. I'm the worship leader. We are so excited that you've joined us for another Sunday service. Be sure to say hello to old faces and new faces. We want to be sure that we are welcoming anybody who is new and joined us for the first time. We're so excited that you are here. Be sure to share and like and comment, especially if you believe that this will be a blessing to someone that you know. Before we get started, we are going to pray. So if you would join us in a word of prayer. God, we just thank you so much for just the ability to be able to worship you, God. We are so thankful for all that you are doing, God. We are thankful for things that you have given and promised us, like joy and peace and kindness and patience. And God, we are just leaning on to you for those things, God. We are leaning into your spirit, just for more of you, God, and we ask that this service, this morning, that you would just pour out your spirit among all of us, God, that we would feel your love wherever we are. God, continue to unite us as a church and as a family. We thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. This is a little bit of a throwback, so be sure to sing if you know this one.
So wonderful is your unfailing love. Your cross has spoken mercy over me. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no heart could fully know how glorious, how beautiful you are. Beautiful one, I love. Beautiful one, I adore. Beautiful one, my soul must sing. Powerful, so powerful, your glory fills the skies. Your mighty works displayed for all to see. The beauty of your majesty awakes my heart to sing. How marvelous, how wonderful you are. Beautiful one, I love. Beautiful one, adore. Beautiful one, my soul must sing. Beautiful one, I love. Beautiful one, I adore. Beautiful one, my soul must sing. Open my eyes to your wonders anew. Capture my heart with this love, 'cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. You open my eyes to your wonders anew. You capture my heart with this love, 'cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you.
We believe you're so beautiful and majestic, God. We praise your name this morning. God, we invite your Holy Spirit to be among us.
Thank you.
Your love sustained me before I even knew what love was. Before I even knew, you've brought me here to thank you.
thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you so much, Lord God, that we can lean back into you, that, Lord God, we can rest in you. Your word says that your yoke is light, that we can rest in you, Lord God. And even at this time, Lord God, for some of us, our workload has gotten so much more, and it seems like the day never ends. Lord God, I pray that you'll help us to find that rest in you. I pray, Lord God, that we will lean back into you, into your loving arms, because you are our Father. You're our Heavenly Father. Lord God, I pray for each and every person that is feeling stress, for each and every person that's feeling anxiety, that is depressed, that doesn't know what's coming next, that maybe they don't even know if their next paycheck is coming. Lord God, I pray that you'll help us to lean back into you, to rest in you, and Lord God, know that you are taking care of us, to have that deep trust in our Heavenly Father. I pray that that will happen. I pray that it will be real and it will feel real as well. Lord God, for anyone that's watching right now that maybe they're curious about you, maybe they don't believe in you fully, I pray right now, Lord God, I challenge them to lean into you, to trust you, and Lord God, you will show yourself so real in their lives. We thank you, Lord God. We praise you, Father God. We pray a special blessing on the rest of our service. We thank you, Lord God, that we praised you, that we worshiped you, that we sang love songs to you, Lord God, because we love you so much. And we're so excited about what you're doing in our life, what you're doing in our church, in our community, in our city. Thank you so much, Lord God. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I want to welcome you to YCA Online. My name is Pastor Vincent, and I'm so glad you're here with us today. I'm joined by Annalie and Ben, and I'm so glad they're here. I just want to give a big thank you to Betsy last week for preaching. Did an amazing job. You let God use you. Thank you so much. And I want to thank each and every person that still is doing things for God, still is volunteering, still being used by God here at YCA. And I thank you so much. And one of the ways that we are used by God, one of the ways we still worship God, is by giving financially. You know, you're not truly submitted to God unless everything is submitted to God. And that's including your wallet, your pocketbook, your bank account. And we thank God that we can give financially to the local church, give financially to God, and we see amazing things happening. And let me just give you a testimony before we actually give. And there's a lot of ways to give. You can drop off your offering at 229 North Broadway, Yonkers, New York, 10701. You can also mail your offering to that same address below. You can also give through our Chase QuickPay app at ycagiving@gmail.com, and also our Cash App at YCA Giving. I want to just give a quick testimony before we pray for our offering. You know, it really is all about obedience when it comes to God. We come to God through salvation, and that is free. But obedience really takes something within us, within our hearts, within our minds, even within our physical bodies, to actually do what God is asking us to do. And one of these things is to give. Give of your time, give of your effort, but also to give financially as well. The only way that a church can actually run and be alive is if its members and congregants, if they give. And if you are obedient to giving, and if you stay faithful to giving, God is going to bless you. And we don't just do it for the blessing. However, I want to share a quick testimony, because us as a church, when money comes into the church, we make sure if it says missions, it goes to missions. If it says tithe, it goes to the general fund offering, goes to the general fund. If benevolence comes in, we make sure it goes to benevolence. For Boxes of Hope, it goes to Boxes of Hope. And we keep on doing what God is asking us to do. We keep on being obedient. We keep on being faithful as a church and as leadership team. And this past week, a really big check came in from the government for something that we were reimbursed for. I don't want to tell you how much it is, but it's a big sum of money. And we thank God, because we didn't see it coming. We weren't expecting it. It was a blessing that came out of nowhere. And this is the thing that God does, not just in the church, but in your personal lives as well. And we're going to be able to use that money to do something great in the church, to do something great in the community, to do something great in this city. And God gives to us so we can give as well. We are blessed to be a blessing. We are blessed to bless others. And once we grasp that and not be closed-fisted with our money, but open-handed, then we see that money doesn't have control over us, but we have control over our money. If we send our money where God wants us to send it, we actually have control over our money, and our money doesn't have control over us. So, continue to be obedient in your giving. Continue to be faithful in your giving. And God is going to bless you. I've seen it in our church's life this week. I've seen it many times over the past 2.5 years in our church's life. I've seen it in my own life as well. I've seen it in others as well. So keep on being faithful to God with your giving. Let's pray for our offering. Dear God, we thank you so much. We thank you, Lord God, that you are so generous to us, and we want to be that example of you and be generous to you as well. Lord God, there are so many in our community and in Yonkers that need to hear your name, that need to be blessed, that need even food and things like that through Boxes of Hope. Lord God, I pray that we'll be able to do that, Lord God, that as you bless us, we will bless others, Lord God, and we will bless YCA as our local church as well, so that we can do more ministry for you, Lord God. We pray for everyone that can give at this time. We thank you for the blessings that you have bestowed on us. And Lord God, we pray, Father God, for those that can't give, that you'll bless them as well, Lord. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, church. God is so good. He is so good, and his blessings are good. His mercies are new every morning. We thank God for that. Here are a couple of announcements. We are reopening as a church. Now, I know other churches have already reopened. Some are staying closed for certain reasons, but we have a start date, a reopening date. It's not a specific date, but we are reopening in mid to late September 2020. Mid to late September 2020, as long as we're in the right phase. Right now, we're in phase 4, but we could be pushed back if it arises again in New York. But right now, New York is doing pretty good, thank God. So keep on wearing your masks, keep on using the hand sanitizer, keep on washing your hands repeatedly, and staying away from people that seem sick and everything like that. So we want to be able to come all together again in September. Now, there are some things. We had a meeting on Wednesday night, just letting everyone know what's going on. We will probably meet again before we do reopen, so everyone can get the instructions. We will send an email out. There will be something to sign as well, where you will know every single thing that you need to do and everything that we're doing in order to open. So, hey, YCA, we're coming back together in September 2020. So we're very, very excited about that. Also, Boxes of Hope is going strong. We gave out about 100 boxes this past weekend, and I encourage you, keep on giving, keep on volunteering, and we are having a big impact on Yonkers. So we thank God for that. Hey kids, it's time for you to get up, stand up, and have some fun. Check this out.
The B-I-B-L-E, yes, that's the book for me.
I want you to think back. I want you to think back all the way before this whole pandemic started, okay, and we had to lock down and close down and all that stuff. What series were we in as a church? I'll give you a hint. We were in a book of the Bible. Put it down there. Let's see who gets it first. Okay, a book of the Bible. It's in the New Testament. It's one of Paul's letters. It starts with a P, sounds like an F. You got it. Okay, someone got it. Philippians. We were in a series in Philippians, and we didn't finish. Actually, Ben had the first quarantine live sermon that he preached, okay? And he was just in chapter 3, and we're going to go to chapter 3 today. But before we get there, I have something for the kids and even the young at heart. Before we go to our title, we're going to try to see if we can see what our title is through pictures. So I want you to look at this first picture. You see it? All right, what is that? All right, let's go to our second picture. Okay, what's that? Third picture. And last picture. I'm going to show you again. So the first one is a goal. Second one is Oreos. Who likes Oreos? Who likes camping? That's a tent. And then we have the word did. So let's put those together, okay? Goal, Oreo, tent, did. Goal, Oreo, tent, did. Say it faster. Goal-oriented. Goal-oriented. Hopefully you got that. Kids, good job. Adults, good job. Teens, good job. So our title for today is goal-oriented. Aren't you glad that God said, I'm going to put these people on earth and I'm going to let them just do nothing and just wander around aimlessly? Absolutely not. God did not do that. God gave us a purpose. Even going back to Adam and Eve, he gave them a purpose to take care of the animals, to take care of the garden. It wasn't hard work back then. Everything was perfect. They didn't have to work it from the sweat of their brow and things like that. But then things got harder. But we still have a purpose. We still have goals in this life. And as Christians, as believers, we should be goal-oriented. We shouldn't just be wandering around the world not knowing what we're doing. So whether you have a goal already, you're seeking a goal, or you have nothing, you're not doing anything right now, you don't know where to go, I hope this helps you today from the words of Paul from the Bible. So let's pray. Dear God, we thank you so much. Thank you, Lord God, that you did not just put us here just to walk aimlessly around the world, just to walk aimlessly around our houses. Lord God, you gave us a goal, and some of us are on task, and some of us are not. Some of us know the goal, some of us do not. Some of us don't even want to look for the goal. We're just so far gone, it seems. But Lord God, I pray that you'll bring us all to a place where we have a goal in mind on earth and even after this life on earth. And I pray, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit will fill me, will use my mouth, will use my words. I pray that the Holy Spirit also goes to each and every home and opens up the minds and hearts and ears and eyes of everyone so that the Holy Spirit can minister. Not just Pastor Vincent, but the Holy Spirit, God, can minister today. Help us to be goal-oriented. In Jesus' name, amen. Everyone say, goal-oriented. Oh, come on, I didn't hear you. Goal-oriented. So let's go to Philippians, and as we go through these verses, we're going to go verse by verse through about 10 or more verses, and we are in Philippians chapter 3. We're starting at verse 12, and we're going to see what Paul the Apostle, the missionary, the great awesome guy from 2,000 years ago, and see what he has to say for us today. So let's go to Philippians 3:12, and it says, "Not that I have already obtained this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me." Paul is trying to say, hey, listen, I know I'm trying to tell you guys what to do. I know I'm trying to guide you in the right way, but I want you to know something. I don't have this all down packed. Jesus is the only one that had it down packed, and I'm trying to follow him. So yes, follow him, but also kind of follow me as well. Because if he is the perfect example, I'm kind of like the imperfect example. Not that I have already attained all this. He hasn't attained all the things that he needs to be as a Christian, all the things that he needs to be as a child of God. And he hasn't arrived yet. He hasn't arrived at his goal. And we're going to find out what that goal is and what our goal should be as well, our overall goal. And you know what? This also tells us something about Paul that, you know, we shouldn't just be satisfied. Satisfaction is the grave of progress. Satisfaction is the grave of progress. If you are just satisfied with your life right now, guess what? You're not gonna have any more progress in your life. You're not gonna take more steps forward. You're not going to get even better than you are right now. If you don't have goals and dreams and things that you want to do, you're just gonna stay in the same place. And like we always said, you know, life is really going up hills and going down hills. So if you try to stay in one place and you're pushing that boulder up the mountain, you're not going to stay in that one place for long. You're going to start sliding down. Satisfaction is the grave of progress. So we can't just be satisfied with where we are right now. And I'm not just talking about money. And I'm not just talking about, you know, houses and cars. Listen, all that stuff is good if you use it for good. Okay? But that can't be our number one goal. We can't be goal-oriented for the things of this earth. Let's keep on going. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. He hasn't taken fully hold of what God has him to do, even though he did so much in his life. He kind of talks down about himself and is humble and says, I still haven't gotten there yet. We need to remember, especially in the spiritual aspects of our lives, never be content with your spiritual attainments. Maybe you could be content with the amount of money that you're making, or the house or the apartment that you have, the car that you have, the amount of kids that you have. But in our spiritual lives, we always have to progress. We always have to go to the next level until we finally reach our goal, which is what? Our goal is heaven, where we find perfection. Never be content with your spiritual attainments. I remember for me, in my life, I remember I first got saved at about 9 years old, didn't really know what that really meant until I was about 14. And at 14, I gave my life totally over to God. It was a transformation. It was something where I was delivered from a lot of things like cursing and listening to certain secular music that was very negative to me and my mind and in my spirit. And there was a lot of things that I just let go, you know, trying to find a girlfriend for, you know, my own reasons. And I let go of a lot of things. And then I started doing certain things like praying and reading the Bible. And I saw that I was saved now, and that salvation, I understood it a little better. And I was living for God. And my next step was possibly, you know, always getting closer to God, yes. But it was possibly to get filled with the Holy Spirit, to get baptized, as called, in the Holy Spirit. Okay, and we find I started to do studies for myself, and I tried to just look for the name Holy Spirit and baptism in the Holy Spirit and filled with the Holy Spirit. And I was going through the Old Testament, filled with the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God came upon them. And then I looked in the New Testament and I saw the day of Pentecost, and that changed my life. Because when I was studying that, and I studied more scripture on the Holy Spirit and who he is and what he does, especially in the lives of believers, we received the Holy Spirit and his guidance and his comfort all the time when we receive salvation. However, to be actually filled up to the top, running over even on other people, right? When we're filled with the Holy Spirit, we receive power to do what God has for us. We receive a supernatural power. And it's not for us just to seek that power. The way I found out how to receive that Holy Spirit was by seeking God, by trying to get closer to God each and every day, by being obedient, by being faithful. And when I was ready, he granted it to me. And it was actually 2 years to the day from when I first gave my life to God. So it was a 2-year journey. And that's the story of the Holy Spirit and I. The Holy Spirit and I had a weird relationship at first. I didn't want to speak in tongues because when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you have evidence that you were filled with the Spirit by speaking in other tongues, another language that you do not know. I know it sounds crazy. I know it sounds even childish, but it's not. I spoke in tongues. I was filled with the Holy Spirit. I felt the peace of the Holy Spirit. And then Satan tried to get in there and say, no, it's not the Holy Spirit. It's something else. You were just speaking craziness. But I felt the power within me. I felt the love within me. I felt the mercy and the grace of God. I felt the peace overall. And then I started really my ministry there. And I remember when I was doing these Bible studies, I was then teaching other people about the Holy Spirit. You don't truly know something until you know it and you can teach it to someone else. And so I was teaching it to kids. I was teaching it to teenagers. I was only 15, 16 years old. And then that's when I finally got so close to God that he was like, okay, you're ready for this. And if you've sought the Holy Spirit before and you sought the baptism and you're like, you know what, I'm not going to do that anymore, I want you to keep on doing it. It just might be that you weren't ready yet and God knows all. So he's going to give it to you when you're ready. So that's kind of a little bit about the Holy Spirit and I and me progressing towards my spiritual attainments. And maybe there's a spiritual gift that you're looking for. Maybe you're looking to, give words of wisdom or words of knowledge or speak in tongues and interpret it or prophesy. These gifts are still alive today. Maybe it's miracles or healing or whatever it is. Maybe it's even preaching and teaching. Let me tell you, let's keep on yearning for these things that God has for us. Never, and I say never, never be content with your spiritual attainments. Keep on pushing forward and ask God for more and more, because all he's going to do is take out the bad and put in the good. Take out the bad and put in the good. And that's what he wants to do in our lives. Philippians 3:13. But one thing I do, he's saying, hey, I haven't made it yet. Hey, I haven't really gotten to the goal yet, but this is the goal, and this is what I'm going to do for the goal. But one thing I do, Paul says, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead. So many of us are held back by our past. So many of us are held back by our sin in the past that we've already been forgiven, and that shame and guilt. When you are forgiven by Jesus Christ of your sin, you are also let go of shame and guilt. You may still feel a little bit bad about what you did. And yeah, maybe you did something against someone else, and that's true. But here's the thing. Jesus has forgiven you. And so you have no more shame, no more guilt, no more condemnation. There's nothing in between you and Jesus anymore, because sin was there before, and it's no longer there anymore. He died on the cross. He died for your sin. He rose again. You don't have to even think about it. And Paul says, I forget what is behind me. Paul helped kill Christians when he was living the Jewish life. He helped kill Christians and helped put many, many more in jail. He persecuted Jesus' disciples, and now he is a disciple of Jesus. And he says, yes, I've done bad things in my past, but now I'm straining toward what is ahead. I'm striving towards what is ahead. And I believe that's the upward call. That's the upward call. And the upward call, I mean, is the upward call to Jesus, the upward call to God, the upward call even to heaven. We're going to see what Paul's goal is in life. And what you do here is either going to get you that goal and get you closer to that goal, or is not going to let you get that goal. Let's keep on going. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me where? Heavenward. Say it out loud. Heavenward in Christ Jesus. He's pressing on to a goal. This goal that we're talking about is not just a goal on earth, even though it's good to have goals on earth. It's good to have dreams for our earthly lives. However, this life is a blink. This life is a blink, and then it's over. That's what the Word of God says. It is a vapor. A vapor, you see it, and then it's gone. So if this is a blink and a vapor, eternity is forever. And maybe that scares you, but let me tell you, heaven is the most beautiful place, the best place, the place you want to be, the place you want to be with God and your loved ones and your huge family of billions of people. He is pressing towards heavenward, and he's pressing towards heavenward in Christ Jesus. That's the only way into heaven, is belief and trust in Jesus Christ. It goes on to say, all of us then who are mature, are you mature, should take such a view of things. So if we are mature disciples in Jesus, yes, we care about this life, because what we do in this life is going to come over to us in the next life. And like I tell you, do you want to get to heaven and have a little shack? Okay. Do you want to just have like a little shelter? Do you just want to have a studio apartment, a one-bedroom apartment, two, three, or do you want a mansion? And yes, there are rewards in heaven for those that do things for God here, not in their own selfish ambition to get to heaven, not in their selfish ambition to look good here on earth, but when we do good unto God, unto others, loving God and loving others, right? When we do that, that transfers and connects us to heaven. And that, when we get to heaven, we're going to see either the studio apartment or the mansion with the pool in the backyard that Jesus went to make for us. All of us then who are mature should take such a view of things. We should have a view that we're only here for a certain amount of time. And we have to do everything we can to love God and love people, those two things. And then we go to heaven forever. Verse 15. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. So if you're not too sure about this whole heaven being your goal thing, then seek God, and God's going to make it clear for you. God is willing to show the truth. Who wants to know the truth? To those who are willing to follow it. He's only going to tell you the will of God for this life and the goal to get to heaven. He's going to tell you those things if you're willing to do it. Not if, hey, God, I think I want to follow you. Hey, God, I'm kind of curious about following you. Hey, God, can you just give me a little sneak peek there? No. If you are ready to follow it, if you're all in, just like Abraham was with Isaac when he brought him to the mountain and was going to sacrifice his son. And then God stopped it right there and gave a sacrificial offering. And then Abraham was off to be blessed by God. We have to be all in. And then God is going to let us know. God is willing to show the truth to those who are willing to follow it. Amen. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. In other words, live up to the will of God, no matter how much knowledge you have. I told you already, when I was 9 years old, very young boy, I gave my life to God, really not knowing 100% what I was doing, maybe not even knowing 5% of what I was doing, but I knew that God was doing something in my young heart that I needed to give my life to him, because I was a mess, okay, with sin in my life, even at a young age, and I needed to give everything to God, and I knew that he healed my dad. It was a miracle, and so I wanted to give my life into the hands of a powerful God. I didn't understand everything, and then at 14, I understood a little more, and then 16, a little more, then 18, going to Bible college. By the end of, I was 22, a lot more, and I'm still learning things about God today. We will never stop learning things about God. However, we need to live up to the will of God, no matter how much knowledge you have. God sometimes only gives you a little bit. Even sometimes he has you walk in a path, and you don't know where the next step is, but he's going to tell you at that right time. So say, God, I want to follow your will. God, I want to follow your plan. God, I want to be goal-oriented. I want to have a goal in life. I want to have a goal to get to heaven as well and to bring as many people with me as possible. I don't have all the knowledge. I don't have all the wisdom. Help me to do it. If I had all, if, 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 if God was telling me to be the pastor of the church, I would have said no, because I would have said, hey, I don't have the knowledge, I don't have the wisdom, I don't have the training. However, I said yes because I felt his leading me into that, even though it seemed crazy to me. It seemed crazy even to my wife. But we went forward and we did it, and God is teaching us and God is giving us knowledge and wisdom. Amen. He'll do the same thing in your life. Let's go to verse 17. Join together in following my example. This is Paul talking. Follow his example, brothers and sisters. And just as you have us as a model, that is Paul and the other leaders that are around him, keep your eyes on those who live as we do. Keep your eyes on those who live as we do. We have Paul as an example. We have even Timothy, and we have Peter, and we have John from the Bible. But we do have examples in our own life. And I would even have to say, we remembered and honored Brother Obi Okundu on Friday. And once again, our condolences go out to the family and the close friends. And there was a lot of close friends here at YCA for Brother Obi. And I knew him since I was about 8, 9 years old. He was, he was actually a singer on the worship team when I first got here. And then he was our Royal Ranger commander. He would give us devotions. But he was also just someone that studied the Word of God all the time. He had that big Bible with just stuff coming all out of it and stuff and bookmarks everywhere. And he was always in the Word of God. And he would even say, up until about a year ago or even months ago, he would say, I want to know more about God. I want to learn more about the Bible. And that was an amazing thing. So we could follow his example. Follow those who are truly following God. That's what we need to do. We need to follow those. We need to look at people and say, you know what? I admire that person. That person is mature as a person, emotionally mature, spiritually mature, and I want to follow a person like that, so that you say, you know what? In 5 years, in 10 years, I want to be someone like that. And so that's who we follow. I just started a program. It's like a healthy habits program, and I have a coach. And really, one of the big reasons why I started this healthy habits program is because of him. I knew him years ago when we did a missions trip to Valley Forge, and we still talked here and there. He was a big guy just like I was, so we hit it off and everything. But then he went on a journey. And he lost over 100 pounds in a year and has kept it off for 4 months. And he's doing great. He lives now in Florida next to Disney World. And before this whole coronavirus, he was doing marathons and half marathons at Disney World. And he would post pics. And he always tried to get me to follow these healthy habits. And I just said, no, I can't do it right now. And then I just looked at him. I said, man, I want that. And here's a picture of him. From over a year ago, about a year and a half ago, he was a big guy, as you see, and now he's a fit, awesome guy. His name is Anthony, and I'm proud to call him my coach because he's been through it, he's done it, and he's keeping it off. So I hope that one day I'll look like that. No offense, Anthony, maybe a little more buff and everything, you know what I'm saying? But he's putting on the muscle as well, so he's an awesome guy. But we need to follow examples of Christ, people that are doing good in life. We need to follow those examples because we'll soon become those or even better than those people that we are following. Let's go to verse 18. For as I have often told you before and now tell you again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. There are people that are against Jesus. There are people that are anti-Christ. There are people that are coming against. There are even false teachers that say that they are for Christ, but they're really not. So, don't follow Judaizers. This is what Paul is saying. And he talked about the Judaizers in the beginning of the book. Judaizers were people that said, okay, you could follow Jesus and accept Jesus, but you also have to be Jewish. And you have to follow all the over 600 commandments that are in the Old Testament. You have to be strict. You have to be circumcised and all this. And then you are saved. That's the Judaizers. They said, we're going to keep all of these big time laws and commandments and everything. And then on the other side, you have these Christians that say, all you need is Jesus and you can sin as much as you want. So don't follow the Judaizers and the Christians with a license to sin. There are many of these that say, oh, only God can judge me. Obviously, God is going to judge you. And also they say, oh, you know what? God knows my heart. You've heard that before. Listen, Jesus didn't die on the cross so you can just sin up and down every single day, every day of the week. Jesus died on the cross so he could forgive you of your sins. Jesus died on the cross so you can live free from sin, not entangled in it anymore. Listen, his grace is enough. His mercy is enough. However, we need to live lives of obedience. We get that free salvation, and then we need to live a life of obedience. So don't follow the Judaizers that have all these strict rules for you. However, don't follow these Christians that are saying, hey, you could do whatever you want and still be a Christian. There has to be some middle point, and that middle point is free salvation and obedience to what God is telling you to do through the Bible, through what he's telling you to do through prayer, what he's telling you to do even right now. Verse 19, their destiny is destruction. So these people are going towards destruction and not heaven. Their God is their stomach, and their glory is in their shame. Their mind is set on earthly things. Just take a second. Is your mind set on earthly things? Only earthly things? Or are you thinking about eternity? Are you thinking about the afterlife? Are you thinking about yourself and for your family, your friends, and the people you know that you want to take with you to heaven? F.B. Meyer once said, there's no chapel in their life. It's all kitchen. And this goes back to what Paul said about their stomach is their God is their stomach. Now there's people, and hey man, I've been this person for a long time, and it's a bad thing that my stomach kind of controls me and my urges and wants for food control me, and maybe you're there as well, and it's like you can't even overcome those things. This is the biggest reason why I'm starting this healthy habits program. But the thing is, our stomach sometimes, maybe it's food, maybe it's alcohol, maybe it's even drugs. Our stomach, our bodies are controlling us. So are you a chapel where the Holy Spirit can dwell? Or are you just a kitchen where you just keep on putting in food and putting in food? And, you know, my relationship with food has been horrible over the years. And I've gained a lot of weight and stuff, and it's not a good thing. Also, we need to remember that selfish acts connect you to this world. When we selfishly do things for us, we think we're getting ahead. However, we're getting behind. And we're getting, if we buy all the newest things and we just are driven by what's new and what's hot and what's awesome in culture, and we're getting the newest phone all the time and the newest laptop and all the newest gear, those things in itself are not bad. However, if you're just consuming for yourself, you're just connecting yourself more to this world. I need to buy that house. I need to buy that car. I need to buy that piece of land. Hey, those things are good. However, they more connect you to this world if you're just doing it for yourself, if you're not thinking of others. Hey, I'm going to get a little bit bigger of a car so maybe I can take some people home from church and give some people a ride. Hey, I'm going to get a room in my house, not for me, but for anyone that really needs a place to stay. So when we actually do these acts for others, we connect to heaven. Acts for others connect you to heaven. Verse 20, but our citizenship is in heaven. That's where we are citizens. Now, we kind of have a dual citizenship, right? We're citizens of this earth, but we're also citizens of heaven. And we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. Our Savior is in heaven preparing us a place. And we have a house or studio apartment in heaven, right? And it's waiting for us there. Hey, there could be additions added onto your house. Let's do things for God and others here, right? Those things that we do not get us into heaven, but they are rewards in heaven. The thing that gets us into heaven is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and believing in him. That obedience and doing things for God and others, those are rewards in heaven. So, Christians have a dual citizenship, not just here on earth, but also we have a citizenship in heaven. And the citizenship in heaven is very important, but the citizenship here on earth is very important as well. It doesn't mean that we don't listen to government, that we don't listen to government leaders. However, if they go against the things of God, then yes, we can go against those things if they're against the things of God, okay? And like I said before, in Matthew chapter 6, it says, where your heart is, that's where you are going to be. Where your things are, where your mind is, that's really your home. So where is your home? So our first loyalty is to God, amen? Just look at this verse here. Who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. When we get to heaven, we will be transformed. It says it in the word of God. We put the work in. We get transformed. We prep during this time. We get transformed in heaven. That's what's going to happen when we get to heaven. Amen. We will have a glorious body like Jesus. It is amazing, 100% perfect and pure. And it talks about eagerly waiting. And eagerly waiting, if there was a picture for it, it would be this picture of Usain Bolt going across the line and just pushing his neck and his head across that line. If we are eagerly awaiting for God to do something, if we're eagerly awaiting for a goal to be met, if we're going towards heaven, we're going to go full force. We're going to go with our head and our chest and our neck out, just like the track star, right? And that's a picture of eagerly awaiting and keeping on going towards that goal. Awaiting our full transformation in heaven. We are going to have a full transformation in heaven. We've been talking about transformation for some time, but our 100% perfect transformation is not going to happen here. Even though we should keep on getting better as disciples of God, we need to remember that in heaven we're going to be perfect. There was a series that we did, and there's a book by a guy named John Burke, and he talks about heaven. It's called Imagine Heaven. And he actually goes through over 100 near-death experiences of people that left this earth and they died and they went to heaven, some went to hell, and they come back and they tell their story. And the stories about heaven are amazing. The stories about hell are gruesome and you don't even want to hear them. However, I want you to hear another story. It's not found in the book. It's from a young guy in his 20s from a church here in the United States in Atlanta. And he just told this back in March 2020. And he had a near-death experience. Check it out.
What did it look like? So the main thing that happened to you was the feeling.
Okay. So the feeling of being there is beyond satisfying. I mean, you are standing there doing I was standing there doing nothing whatsoever, and I had the most complete feeling of accomplishment and satisfaction than anything I can imagine to do here. I mean, everybody, we all have dreams, we all have goals, we all have financial things we want to meet. I mean, you take hitting the lottery, whatever you want to, whatever it comes to your mind, the best thing you could think of is not, it is nothing compared to just standing there. I mean, you just standing there looking at God, waiting to hear what he has to say. And it sounds funny, but like, it's rather comfortable. I mean, it's not hot, it's not cold. I mean, there's nothing, it is a body though. People think you're just this ghost floating around.
You had a body.
You have a body. It's
spiritual
like,
body.
Yeah, it's a spiritual body, but it's perfect.
You saw definition?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Were you buff?
Yeah, you know, I was, you know what I'm saying? 350, you know, something like. No, it's a mature body. If I had to take an educated guess, I would say he probably puts you like a 25 to 30 year old body, something that's mature, everything's fully developed, but it's a real body.
So you have feet, you can walk, you have substance.
Mm-hmm. There's no hair.
So you
like
can
that.
Feel. You don't do this and your hand goes through. You feel.
No, yeah, this isn't like Casper. We're floating around. No, it's not like that. You have a real body. It's hairless. You don't feel hungry. You don't feel thirsty. You don't feel the urge to use the bathroom. It's nothing like that. You're empty almost inside. It's like you're filled with nothing but the presence of God. There's nothing inside of you.
Man.
Yeah.
Wow.
There's no satisfaction you can get from using the bathroom or eating food or drinking water. There's nothing.
So you have no need.
No, there's no need except for him. There is nothing else you need, period. You don't remember anything on earth. You don't remember who you loved, who you didn't love. There is nothing you remember. All you remember is God. I'm here to serve God. That's it. There's nothing else you're worried about.
Did he speak to you?
No.
Didn't say anything? Mm-hmm. Did he look at you?
No.
Okay, you were just there. I
was just there. I was standing in front of him. I'm like, I don't have this big, you know, he came down and I am God. No, it's none of that. I was standing there. He was sitting on his throne. It's like he paid me attention, but he was so God that I was just there in his presence. It's like he knew it was just an honor for me to be there. There was no instruction. There were no words. I have no big dramatic plot twist. I was just standing there, and next thing you know, boom, I'm back.
It's just amazing that he and other people have gone through experiences like that. Sometimes I think that I would like to go through an experience like that, but then I would have to come really, really close to death. But those things, it tells me that our goal to really get to heaven is a journey. And our goal to get to heaven is a real goal. That it's not something, it's called the blessed hope. We hope for it. It's blessed by God. Jesus is preparing a place for us. That is our goal. So us as Christians to be goal-oriented means that we have our eyes set on heaven, but we don't have our eyes nowhere in the world. We need to make sure that we're loving God and we're loving people and we're blessing others. We are blessed to be blessed. And as our goal is heaven, here's our bottom line for today. When it comes to heaven, salvation and obedience are the main ingredients. Can we say that together? When it comes to heaven, salvation and obedience are the main ingredients. You see, a lot of people just think, hey, I just got to get saved. Hey, Jesus is enough. Hey, it's okay. I can sin as much as I want. No, it's salvation, which is free. Jesus died on the cross for you, but it's also obedience. He is still alive today, and we serve an awesome God, and we serve a Lord and King. So we need to be obedient and listen to what he says. Amen? And it goes without saying that in heaven, we are going to be transformed. So we can even put in there, when it comes to transformation, salvation and obedience are the main ingredients. If you truly want to be transformed, then you need to give your life to God and obey what he says, and you are going to go through a transformation. And when you're in heaven, you're going to go through the most pure, 100% perfect transformation that you've ever experienced. So we've been talking about transforming lately. We've been talking about becoming a better person here on earth. But the true, perfect transformation that we're talking about here, it's only going to happen when we get to heaven. And heaven is going to be a glorious place. It's going to be a perfect place. And I can't wait to get there, and I can't wait for you to get there. And I want to bring myself, but everyone I can with me. Don't you? So when it comes to transformation, true transformation, and being in heaven, salvation and obedience are the main ingredients. Salvation is free. Jesus paid for it on the cross. He died on the cross. He rose from the dead. And when he died, all our sins died with him. And we can tap into that. We just need to take the step towards him. He's waiting for us. He's knocking at the door. Are you ready to give your life fully to him? And then if you're already living for God and you accepted that free gift of salvation, it's time to be obedient. It's time to listen to what he's saying to do, to get in the word and see what it says in the word, to apply the things that the Holy Spirit is speaking to you about right now, during the week, during times of prayer, when you're talking to other people and the Holy Spirit is using them to get to you. So, are you ready to give your life to God? Are you ready to be obedient? If you're ready to give your life to God, I want you to repeat this prayer after me. You're going to put your trust, you're going to put your hope, you're going to put your faith in Jesus at this time. And you're going to start living for Him. You're going to start being obedient. You're going to make sure you're here on Sundays and you're worshiping God and you're learning about God. And also that you're meeting with God each day in prayer and reading your word. Let's pray together. If you want to give your life to Jesus right here and now, repeat these words and really mean it in your heart and in your head. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for giving your son, Jesus, to me. Thank you for sending him to die on the cross, to forgive me of my sins, and raise back to life 3 days later. I ask for forgiveness from all my sins. Wash me clean. Holy Spirit, help me to walk with God each and every day. Give me new life. I'm no longer the old person, but now I am a new creation in Jesus Christ. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, make sure you comment down there that you accepted Jesus. We want to celebrate with you. You can message us. If you want more material and if you need a Bible, we'll send it to you. You are living for Jesus now, and all of Heaven NYCA is celebrating with you. So congratulations. You are now a believer in Jesus Christ. But this is only the starting point. Now starts the time to be obedient. So I'm going to say a prayer that we can be obedient to God. So let's pray. Dear God, we thank you so much for this word. That Lord God, if we truly want to be transformed, if we truly want to make it to heaven, but also bring others with us, we need salvation, yes. But also we need to be obedient in this life. We can't just have all these abundance of rules on one side, and also we can't just have a license to sin on the other side. We need to be obedient. We need to be obedient to your word. We need to be obedient to what the Holy Spirit is asking us to do. You're not going to make us be like robots. Lord God, you want us to truly love you. And Lord God, we want to love you. We want to obey your commands. Help us to do that, Lord God. Even when it's so hard, I pray, Lord God, that you will come through. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.